Well, of course, Simon, your connection with GDV9 is the fact that Corky was your uncle, as we've discussed many, many times, and became King Corky, King of Kids.
Yes, and for those who are my age or younger, Phil's referring to a gentleman named Jeff Cork, who was the first man on television in Victoria.
Yes, and somebody who was a part of Channel 9 from the very, very start was Ron Blaskett, and we're thrilled to have Ron with us tonight to talk about the good old days at Channel 9. And to start with, here's Patty McGrath and a song from the Christmas Panto of 1963.
So I was wishing that some wonderful miracle could happen, and that Rosalinda could be beautiful again. Even if just to teach my father a lesson.
If you wish hard enough, a wish can come true.
Can it?
Yes. Haven't you ever heard?
Wishing will make it so. Just keep on wishing.
Did you notice, Simon, in the film clip we were watching, not only was Patty singing the song, so too was Ron Blaskett and Jerry G.
That's a pretty impressive trick.
How do you do that, Ron Blaskett, and good evening?
Well, I'll tell you how I did that. I listened to Flanagan and Allen, who were mentioned earlier, and when they sang in unison, as they did always, I noticed that it was only at the beginning and end of the song that you could tell there were two voices, and I used that in a special way later on.
It was terrific. Talk about showmanship.
Yeah.
Were you at Channel 9 at the very beginning?
Before the opening, the official opening, I was there with my wife on October the 20th, 1956, and my wife Merle was the first female on GTV9, and I'm wondering if anyone would know the name of the ventriloquial figure that she used and used once a week later in the Tarak show.
Oh,
the happy show as it was then.
How interesting. Somebody might ring in and tell us.
Well, perhaps I can guess.
96900693. We'll have a prize for you. First one to get the answer right. A wonderful prize. How's the book going? You and me and Jerry G.
Very good, because it's not in bookshops and it sells steadily, and we're very pleased with it, but young Ron has them, and it saves all the trouble of getting books into bookmakers who are going broke and getting them out again later.
It's a wonderful book. It traces not only your history, but so much about showbiz in Australia. You worked with some fascinating people during the war, didn't you? I think including Happy Hammond.
I didn't work with him, but he was one of the 400 of us who were in the Pagewood film studios in Sydney, and we were split into different groups. But in Queensland, our show, which was produced by Max Reddy, Alan Reddy's father, was taken to see their show, and Keith Glover was his straight man, who became very well known at the ABC, and he used to do the Anzac Day march every year.
So are you actually in the army?
Oh, my word.
Yeah, what rank did you rise to?
Very rank. Sergeant. Sergeant, and they tell me that's the highest you could go and still have friends.
Now, who was there with you in the entertainment group?
Originally, Eddie Cordray of the ABC, a wonderful arranger, and most of the ABC bands, Lou Tapano, one of the best accordionists in the world, and the name that a lot of people in not your age group, but Simon's age group will remember, Smokey Dawson.
Oh, yes.
And I became best man at his wedding.
Oh, great.
Is that right?
To June Cheers, Florence Cheers.
Florence Cheers.
Who became Auntie June on the Peter's Powell show with Billy Bouncer.
That's right.
Yeah.
Smokey Dawson, once when being interviewed by Bruce and Phil, told us, the many times we interviewed him, he was lovely and cheerful and happy. One day they asked him about his childhood, and he'd told us the story of his childhood, which was quite a sad tale.
Yes, well, in his book he says that, but he does say that he was born Dawson. He was actually born Herbert Brown, and he changed his name by a deed poll during the war.
Yes.
And Dawson came from Dawson Street, Brunswick.
Really?
He lived near there, and he never mentioned it. And it's a big fib at the start of the book that born Dawson. He was born Herbert Brown. Yeah. I know because I was best man at his wedding,
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
It's a good thing you didn't live on the Nepean Highway. Smoky Nepean just doesn't have quite the same ring to it. And now, Ron, I want to go right back to the very beginning.
Right.
If you don't mind me saying, you're in your 90s.
94 next birthday.
94. Uh-huh. So going back to the 1920s, as young Ron's running around in little shorts, where did the idea of show business come from? What was the first thing that inspired you to not be a mechanic or a bank clerk?
My father was persuaded to leave the job as a secretary to the start of the Colonial Bank by one of the Arnott's Biscuits people to start the Boy Scout movement in Australia.
Oh, wow.
And in the course of our duties, we spent a short time in Perth, and while there we went to a boy's home, and I saw a Professor Turner working with a talking doll, which I'd never seen before. And as the doll was placed in the case, the voice came apparently from the case. And years later, when I was production manager live at Channel 9 Perth, people rang up and said, "Our grandfather was Professor Turner. We've got his dolls. Would you like them?" Oh. Boy, would I like them. Wow. The first doll I'd ever seen. Oh. And that doll is now in the Performing Arts Museum. So what a wonderful present to be given.
That's fabulous.
And that was the start of my wanting to be a ventriloquist.
Okay, and how did Jury G come to be named?
Named after GTV, alliterative, easy to remember, and we used to use not so much the 972 as GTV, yes. HSV. So Jerry G of GTV was memorable, easy to remember, and alliterative.
So if you went to Channel 9 in October 1956, that was prior to the Olympic Games, of course.
That's right.
And what were you doing there then?
Well, rehearsing a show and going through to give the cameraman work. The show that we did later in the year, Do You Trust Your Wife?
Yes.
Which Bergen had done in America, and they bought the rights of it here.
Okay. And what about opening night? Were you a part of that in January 1957?
Too right I was. I was opening night, and Terry Deer was the compere, and Lou Tapano was the band leader. So a lot of people, if you ask who was the first band leader at Channel 9, would say Lee Gallagher, and then later Arthur Young. But it was actually Lou Tapano.
Who then went to 7 after that?
Well, you see, he was already working in radio for 3DB.
Oh, I see.
And he would have, had he stayed at 9, lost his money and super and all that, so he couldn't stay on.
So tell us about opening night. So Dallas Brooks was the governor back then, wasn't he?
Yes, and did a very good speech that if you didn't like that particular channel, turn the dial.
I know. It's not very diplomatic, was it?
No.
And was 7 already on the air by then?
I think they were on the air about that time.
Yeah, okay.
And I think Corin Kirby had probably raced us to air at that time.
At Channel 2.
Yeah.
As a hostess there. And so, thoughts of the first children's show. How did that evolve at Channel 9?
We did a dry run of it. It was to be originally with Nicky, and Nicky was well known with Nicky and Tuppy, Nicky and Nancy Lee, and Nicky and Graham.
Yes.
But Nicky died at the wrong time, so Happy hadn't got his chance through that. And I must say, he did his job very well.
Yeah.
In your opinion, would Nicky have worked on television? Because there were some who could easily make the transition. There were others who just never managed to crack TV, who were very big on radio.
Mm-hmm.
Nicky would have been very big in television because I'd work with him live at live shows, which were more an advertisement for the radio. And he worked so well and did such good comedic bits that I'm sure he would have been very big. Mm. The same as Roy Rean Moe, who I had worked with, but he would have been good, produced by Norman Spencer and working. But Jack Davey, of course, was an ill man when he got into his kinescope, which is not that good.
That's right.
But I think he would have been eventually very good.
What did you think of Bob Dyer's performance on TV?
Oh, brilliant.
Yes.
Well, Bob Dyer swept the boards with his pick a box.
And you know, Graham Kennedy used to say, no, Nicky would have been a failure on TV, and that hurt Nancy Lee greatly, Nicky's widow.
I don't agree. I think that he would have been very big. Bob Dyer, whose name, incidentally, was D-I-E-R.
Oh, yeah?
Not a good name for show business.
The last of the Tennessee Hillbillies,
yes.
He was.
I forget the name of his wife.
But Dolly Mack.
No, it was a different name to that, which you can get on your computers. She became Dolly Dyer, a brilliant, lovely lady.
I think she was from the Tivoli, wasn't she?
Tivoli, Sydney.
Yes.
But his first show in Melbourne was at the Princess Theatre, and it was called The Marcus Show. And it was about the first time that they had girls with just G-strings in tableau at the Princess Theatre.
Is that true?
Yes, that's true. And the Marcus Show, there was a fellow called Ernest Rolls earlier, but the first in my era was the Marcus Show, and Bob Dyer did a stand-up comedy act, The Last of the Hillbillies.
Now, Ken, I want you to find, there's a very good reason for this, the soundtrack from Pinocchio, When You Wish Upon a Star, because Ron has a wonderful story related to Cliff Ukulele Edwards, who sings this song in the movie. And, of course, it's sort of synonymous with Disneyland, isn't it, Simon, and all Disney productions?
Oh, very much so. And it's sort of the theme for Disney, isn't it, really?
Well, it has been through the years. And, in fact, Ron will tell us about having worked with Cliff Edwards locally here in Melbourne, it would turn out. I didn't realise he'd ever been to Australia.
Now, you see, Ron, if Phil had given this a bit more thought, he would have prepped Ken earlier to get this piece out so that he wouldn't have to pad whilst he was trying to find it. But Ken's got it for us
now. I don't need to pad. I'm just filling you in, folks. I wish I'd gone to the Plaza Northcote to enjoy Cliff Edwards. Is that where you worked together?
Yes, and with a juggler who was a Royal Command performer called Ribbler. And they had great difficulty getting them ready for the show with black coffee every night.
Oh, tell me why.
They drank something more than Tarax during the day.
Really?
But still, his he was very entertaining.
What year would this be, Ron? during the TV years?
Well, I know that I hadn't peroxided my hair in those days, but I would, memory is not as quick as it used to be, and it was prior to television, of course.
Okay, what sort of a man was Cliff Edwards?
Pleasant, yeah. And all right to get on with.
And a good entertainer on stage?
Oh, yes, he wouldn't have been. The Plaza Northcote standard was pretty high.
Yes.
And I certainly don't think he would have been booked had he not been good.
And did you become mates?
Oh, no. No, okay. Well, his activities...
He was a big star, was he?
Well, I was married, not so much that, but his activity during the day wouldn't have been approved by my darling wife, Merle.
Oh, really? Oh, really? A bit of a... profligate, perhaps, huh?
That's a good word.
Yes.
Did Simon give you that?
We've really assassinated him tonight, haven't we? A booze artist and a lustful man.
There's something I would like to say to Patty McGrath, who you had on, as she was then.
Yes.
She was brilliant to work with.
Uh-huh.
And I thought I'd always like a daughter like Patty. She was so brilliant at what she did.
Yes, yes.
But I had to wait for three granddaughters and a great-granddaughter, so the feminine side is a bit strong now in my family. I hope they hyphenate their name later.
Let it be known, and it's been spoken of before, the two favourite people I've worked in television and radio over 60 years are Simon Owens and Patty Newton. My two favourite people to work with, which is a bit of a slap in the face to everybody else I've ever met.
Yeah, I wouldn't go public with that, really.
Why can't I? I'm proud to say it.
After 50-something years in show business, you're happiest with your panel operator.
You know, the Simon... Simon here hasn't had his photo in the Green Guide yet, have you?
No, I haven't, no.
Well,
are you able to pull some strings for me?
Yes.
Ah, Morocco, land of mystery and spice.
And crawly things and insects not nice.
Land of romance and of fabulous gold.
And here are you left out in the cold.
Cold? I'm not cold. I'm as snug as a bug in a Persian rug. I'm a chappie who is happy as an ant. And no one could be happier than that. I'm a fellow that just doesn't give a shrug, for I'm snug as a bug in a Persian rug. I'm an elf that is so happy with itself, or a mouse with cheddar cheese up on the shelf. No hot water bottle need I ever hug, for I'm snug as a bug in a Persian rug. I'm not cold or not unwanted anymore, not a wallflower when the dancers take the floor. No shivers when I pull the bathroom plug, for I'm snug as a bug in a Persian rug.
He's a pasher who is cutting quite a dash. He's a fellow who is anything but rash. And the reason that we're feeling very smug, we're all snug as a bug in a Persian rug.
Oh, beautiful. Ron Blaskett and Jerry G and Joffa Boy, Joff Helen, accompanied by Margot Sheridan and Laurie Wilson. Did you write that song, Ron?
Oh, no. No, that was a standard. But I wrote all the other theme songs for the show, and the Toodaloo song, which was used for years after by Cartoon Corner.
Of course.
Katrina Roundtree.
Yes.
Katrina, not Roundtree.
Now, a little bit of homework that you mentioned a name before, as in Dorothy or Dolly, the wife of Bob Dyer. I've found her name to be Thelma Phoebe McLean.
That's it.
Would that be right?
That's correct, yes.
There we are.
Now, James of Moody Ponds, good evening to you.
Hello, Philip and Simon, and hello, Ron.
Hello, James.
Ron, you had a long-standing love affair with Merle.
Still a love affair, 71 years married.
Wow. Yeah, now how about Jerry G? Did he ever get together with Sandra Simpkins?
Sandra Simpkins, they seem to have a good comedy relationship, but no, they never got together and there was no progeny. And there were the Geraldine Dolezal, which was a female version of Jerry G. Jr., which is still made by my friend Gordon Rossett in One Turner. He has the moles and he makes a beautiful job of them.
And you know, James, because you identified Sandra Simpkins, and you are the first in, we're going to award you the wonderful book, You, Me and Jerry G. You are going to love it, and Ron, I think, will sign it for you, James.
Thank you very much. Ron has already signed a fan card at the toy show at the exhibition buildings, and also I've got a fan card signed by Patty McGrath, and she wrote on it, love.
That would be the year after the exhibition building was built.
How cruel is that? Hang on for your prize, James. Well deserved for identifying Sandra Simpkins. Yeah. Now, talk about the Corky connection with Ron, please, because it's so fascinating when you think of Jeff's involvement with the Tarek Show.
Well, look, I'm almost embarrassed to mention that I'm the nephew of Uncle Jeff. Jeff is not a blood relative of mine. He married my aunt. My aunt was one of five sisters, Sue, and Sue married Jeff, being his second wife after he and Val separated.
Matron at the Masonic Hospital.
That's correct, yes. Yeah. That's where they met when Jeff was there and not well. But I'd ride on the coattails of being the nephew of Jeff Cork, but I can't claim to have inherited any talent from him.
Well, Simon, I was at the Danish Club on a Sunday night having a meal with Bernard the Magician, who owned Bernard's Magic Shop there in Elizabeth Street. And I talked to Ron Kinnear about Jeff needing a symbolic role for a kid's show. And he scratched his head, as he was wont to do, and said, oh, Jeff's got an image already. But it was the wrong image, and I thought he'd need something. And it came to me at the Danish Club, Corky, King of the Kids.
Yeah.
And it worked brilliantly. And he was such an imposing big fellow and a very pleasant man, very big in radio, 3DB. And it worked, and I found him a joy to work with. And at that stage, Jerry G got arms and was able to gesticulate and drink the Tarex and all that.
Yes.
And I really enjoyed working with Jeff.
Well, it's a great name you came up with, because whenever, in all my life, whenever the television connection happens and somebody, you know, finds out that I'm the nephew of Jeff Cork, they all say, oh, Jeff, oh, Corky, King of the Kids. And that's just how he's identified.
I think he was the most successful rating-wise that we had because of that. But probably he was a little embarrassed by it all, because he'd been a big star and been the first on. Mm. A lot of people, when you say to them in my shows that I've been doing up till a year ago, who was the first on television, they say Bruce Gyngell because of the publicity. But we couldn't see Bruce Gyngell in those days.
Right. And, of course, I think Corky was promoted to King of the Kids at the time that Happy Hammond left the Tarek Show to go across to Seven. Is that what happened?
Yes, well, we had to have somebody, and that's who got the job. And Happy went to Seven. It was okay, because Norm had gone, and Happy was not under contract. I had 2 years to run on contract, so there's no hope of me going without a lot of legal things, which would have been very messy.
But Norman Spencer wanted you at Seven, I'm sure.
What was the name of the lovely gentleman in charge of Seven in those days?
Was it Keith Cairns?
Keith Cairns. Thank goodness your memory's still good. And Keith was a lovely man, and we'd been to his home, and I wanted to go with Happy. I thought we were a good team.
Yes.
But the legal side of it would have been bad, so I stayed on at Nine.
And, of course, this is, water under the bridge. Graham Kennedy and Jeff Cork had a big falling out, and I'm aware of what the situation was. So it was very timely, when Graham really didn't need Corky because of Bert Newton being on the scene, for Jeff to make the transition to the children's show. The timing was impeccable.
It was, and it worked, and that was the main thing. And so far as the comedy was concerned, it was good-o.
Yeah. We have another caller for you, Ron. Jill calls from Geelong. Hello, Jill.
Hello.
Hello, Jill from Geelong.
Yes, Ron, I am Lottie's daughter.
Whose daughter?
Lottie.
Lottie? Does that name ring a bell, Ron?
Yes, Arnie Self and Uncle Les.
Oh, of course, yes. Dear...
We're in Western Australia?
Oh, yes. Well, Sylvan and Les, they were a friend of ours from because they used to supply the meals for the concert party, which was called the Araroos over the road. They had a mixed business in La Trobe Street, and they became friends for life through supplying the Araroos with their midday meal.
Ron, can I leave my phone number up there?
Yes, certainly.
So that you could get in touch. We haven't been in touch for years.
Okay, now I've got a surprise for you, Jill. I'm going to present you with the DVD, You and Me and Jerry G, by Ron Blaskett, 60 years in Australian showbiz. We're going to send you that DVD, Jill.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, and hang on and we'll exchange phone numbers off the air.
Now, Ron, I have to ask, being a ventriloquist and being, you know, the greatest we've had in Australia on TV, were there other ventriloquists who you watched, admired, or loathed and thought they were lousy?
No, the main one was Clifford Guest. He was my inspiration, and he married one of a musical trio, went to London with two other acts from here, and he was successful on getting in the Palladium. He did marvellous voice, air raids and distant voice and things like that. I could never attempt to be in the same street as him with these sounds that he could do, but there was no reason why I couldn't have a comedy duo. So to me, the personality of Jerry G was important, and I became relatively famous long before television because I was a good comedy duo. And I was the straight man, never attempted to be funny, but Jerry G was accepted as a comedy character. But there are ventriloquists now who can do the most marvellous things. But whether they can do 16 years, five nights a week, 10 at 9 and 4 in Western Australia, and still be in charge of live, is a different ball game.
And I understand that Jerry G has been known to work a bit blue at smoke nights. Is that true?
Have you ever tried doing a church concert at a smoke night? I can tell you what, it doesn't work.
Okay.
Unless you hit them between the eyes with your first gag, you're dead.
Okay.
And I manage smoke nights very well.
Okay. Now, I have a little role here at 3AW as being a bit of a station historian. I'm forever researching.
Thank goodness you've got a job in this opulent valley.
Sunday night, we'll find out how we are tomorrow.
Well, so far.
Yes, but there was a ventriloquist who was on 3AW many years ago, and I'm wondering whether you're aware of him and his work.
Not only aware of him, but knew him very well. Mel Virko and Ginger.
Exactly, yes.
And they were very successful. They came from Adelaide, where they were sponsored by the Supreme Boot Polish Company. They were brilliant on radio. They were shocking visually. Ginger had a great big head on him. It's a photo of him in my book, incidentally. But you've got to say, with the falsetto voice, there was a distinction, and he was very good. When he came over here, I got to know him. He threw his career away through liking the booze too much. He finished up in a place out Bundoora way for alcoholics, and he published their little newsletter, and he used to send me one of those. I got friendly with him. All the inmates out there wrote to Nigel Dick and said, the IMT needs a little Ginger in it. And they put him on one night. Freddie Parsons wrote a script, and it was pathetic because he used to hide his lips with a holder and cigarette, and it didn't work, and it was a great shame.
Perhaps he wrote the letters himself.
It was not visually good.
Okay. He was one of the Lee Murray players as well, Mal Virko.
He did the blind shows, travelling from Adelaide.
Now, a couple of other events. What did you think of the late Dennis Spicer?
Oh, Dennis was great because we did double acts together.
Yeah.
And they're on that DVD of mine.
Okay.
Working with Dennis. We did twice on IMT. About 2 years apart.
Yeah.
And I was shocked when he went back to England and got killed in a car accident.
Yeah, tragic.
28 years of age.
And what about David Strassman more recently? David Strassman.
Oh, well, he's taken a lot of money out of Australia and he's a brilliant entertainer.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we'll take a break, Ron, and come back with our guest, Ron Blaskett. Blaskett, you knew Graham Kennedy better than most. What sort of a man was he, away from the cameras?
Well, he was very courteous to me. I think he had an appreciation of my work, and he asked to come to my place, and we'll cook him a roast dinner in the first year of television. And he brought all his scrapbooks, and Graham was quite famous before television, radio, certainly very good in radio. But after that, he got terribly busy, and I had my own problems and work to do, coming up with fresh material every night. So in later years, I didn't know him so much. But when I came back from Perth, because my parents were getting old, he asked, would I write the funnies of the day? So I used to get up at 5 o'clock, living at North Baldwin, get the papers, take the news headings and write a comedy bit, phone it through to him at Oliver's Hill, to Wendy Hanson, his secretary, and then we listened to see how we scored with the funnies for the day. And the company was Craig Austin, and I always got the check from them on time.
Oh, we'd never bounce, that's for sure. Did you know Graham socially? Did you have dinner together at his home or whatever?
Never, no. By that time he got very big. But he had a roast dinner cooked by Merle at my place.
Oh, good to hear.
Now, Ron, we've got another call for you here. Julie is in Geelong. Hello, Julie.
Hello, how are you?
Julie, how nice to hear from you. Geelong is one of my favourite places because the Betts family down there were great friends of mine.
Oh, okay. And I can't say I know them, sir, but what I would love to say to you is that I'm 55 and I have Geraldine.
So you just come in onto this earth after television had started, Julie?
Yeah, well, I've got Gerald. Gerald, I'm so excited to be able to speak to you. I just came in before, turned on the radio, and there was you there, and I just said, oh, look, I've never rang a radio station before, and I had to ring up, and I have Geraldine, like Jerry G's sister.
Well, if you have that in the original box...
No, I don't have that, but I've got her, and she's just amazing.
Where do you keep her, Julie?
Well, I tell you what, I keep her on the couch or on the somewhere where I can speak to her, if you know what I mean. I was given her. I was raised with three brothers, so I had the pop rifle. I never had a doll.
Well, it's worth it.
I never had a doll, you know what I mean? And then I ended up with a doll when I was very, very young, and she's still with me, and I'm 55 now. I got her when I was about 8, I would say. I haven't got the box that she was in, but I have her, and she's in perfect condition.
Worth $3,000, Julie.
There you are. You've struck gold, Julie. Thanks for calling.
Although I think by the sound of it, it's a good companion for Julie, and she'd never pass.
Oh, she wants to cuddle it. You'd be very proud of both your sons, Peter and Ron Jr.
Not only am I proud of them, but I love them dearly. And Ronald is a tower of strength to me. My life would be very different without him looking after my daily needs because my ambulation is not too good. And Ronald is the kindest, loveliest man. And he's so courteous to everyone he comes in contact with. And I love him dearly.
Yeah, and of course, Peter's followed in your footsteps, hasn't he?
Yes, but not now. Peter is in the Philippines.
Oh.
He sold up here, and he has built a rice processing mill, and it's brilliant.
Gee, that's a switch from being a man. The 60-year-old history of Australian showbiz, the Jerry G story with press cuttings, photos, colour photos, hardcover edition, a great story. There's only about 200 left. There'll never be a reprint. Autograph ones are getting over $250 at auction, but it's only $40 by phoning Ron Blaskett Jr. on 9842 98425458. That's 98425458. Can you also buy the DVDs as well, Ron?
Yes, they're produced by Bob Phillips, who used to produce Hey Hey, It's Saturday.
Of course. And Ron, thanks so much for coming in to Ron Jr. Great to see you both. We could talk for hours, but you truly are one of the legends of Australian television.
We could talk for hours, but you want to keep your top rating, don't you?
We'll try. We'll try, Ron. Good night. Rumble.